I just wanted to say that Maysoon says she's not famous, but not only does she have a TED Talk that has over 9 million views, but she...
Over 48 million views.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Okay, so she's even more famous than I thought. But I was going to say, not only that, but if you actually Google cerebral palsy, which is what we both have, she comes up in the Wikipedia article.
Cool.
And I happen to know she lives with Beyonce, too.
I do. I live with Beyonce.
Yes.
I do.
Anyway,
that's it.
So now that we got that out of the way, you know, I've really been thinking about the role of comedy in anticipation of this conversation because, I don't know, I feel like for me, my comedy comes from a lot of my accidents every day, not necessarily being funny on purpose. Usually it's not a conscious thing. So I was thinking about identity and how I use comedy in a subconscious way. For example, in introducing myself to people, I'll often say, oh, I'm Chinese and Jewish. My friends call me Jewish. And it gets, you know, usually gets some chuckles. And I want to also say it's kind of cool that the two of us can represent three monotheistic religions all in, on the stage. But, you know, I was thinking about what is it like to be not just have, you know, comedy be a part of your the way you talk to people, but have it be your identity.
Yeah. So what's interesting is I became a comedian before I ever identified as anything else. So when I became a comic, I wasn't conscious of the fact that I was a woman and women aren't funny. And I wasn't, you know, I do a line in the TED Talk where I say I got 99 problems and palsy is just one. And in the oppression Olympics, I'd win the gold medal because I'm Palestinian, I'm Muslim, I'm a woman of color, I'm disabled, and I'm from New Jersey. So.
Exactly.
When you take all those things together, when I started doing stand-up comedy, I didn't realize that it was a big deal to be a minority because comics are the rejects. Right. I became a comedian because my dream in life was to be on General Hospital, like most Muslim girls, right? And I didn't get cast, and I started looking at television and realizing that people who looked like me weren't on TV. Mm. But I did see me in comedy. Right. Number one being Richard Pryor, the original shaking comic. But also identifying with people like, you know, Doris from The Drew Carey Show, or Ellen, or Rosie O'Donnell, or anyone that wasn't this, like, cookie-cutter perfect what I thought Hollywood wanted. So I was like, okay, I'll become a comedian, and then I'll become a huge rock star. And again, never thought, oh, it's a big deal that I'm a Muslim woman doing comedy. Yeah. A decade later, people are like, hey, did you know you were the first Muslim woman to do comedy? I'm like, no, nobody's first.
So you can I ask you a question about that, actually?
Yeah, yeah.
So have your motivation...
Am I imposing Sharia law on this room? Yes, I am. Jihad.
Okay. No, but I'm wondering, though, over time, have your motivations changed now that you're more conscious of its social impact and also your personal impact? And, you know, one of the things I like to say in my advocacy is the personal is universal, and I think your TED Talk is such a great example of that, because not only was it funny, but it was, you know, touching, moving, it gave us a sense of your history, and it was much deeper than just a really wonderful, hilarious talk.
So I always say laughter comes first. Like, I don't care if anyone learns anything or if there's any message, as long as they're laughing first. I think if I ever get too into, this is my platform to free Palestine, it stops being funny, you know.
It's too serious.
No, if that's your goal is the message, you won't be funny anymore. Right. So I think that my message comes from the fact that my comedy is personal. And if I'm talking about me, then I'm talking about what it's like to be a disabled American in Trump's Armageddon, where people with disabilities are targeted by every single aspect of that administration's new rules, everything from education to healthcare to tax cuts to rolling back the ADA is directly affecting us. So when I sit and talk about my personal life, mm-hmm. those issues always come into play. But I think prior to the TED Talk, I was very irresponsible and just like a happy-go-lucky comedian that was like, what's not funny about rape and pedophilia? I think it's hilarious. And after I did the TED Talk, that's when I became a responsible human being. Mm. That's when I found out that I was ableist and didn't know it. Like, stupid and crazy are my two favorite words. And my friends with disabilities were like, but that's ableist, and you're stigmatizing mental health, and you're stigmatizing intellectual disabilities. And I fought them to the death. I mean, I think you watched me be like, I cannot give away stupid, I can't do it. But with the TED Talk, it was the Spider-Man moment. It was the moment that I knew I had such great responsibility, because people were reaching out to me saying I was gonna kill myself until I saw this talk, and then I realized that I could be functional. I realized that it was okay that my parents didn't accept me because I could find a world of people with disabilities ready to make me part of their ohana. And in that moment, I realized that I didn't want to make people sad with my comedy. I didn't want to trigger the worst moments of their life. It was no longer funny to me.
Right.
So it was less about the message and more about wanting everyone to truly have fun and understanding that being ableist, misogynistic, bigoted didn't do that.
Hmm. That's interesting.
I also just flew from Kuwait, and everyone in the audience looks like Fraggles, so I'm like super goofy and not responsible for anything I say.
Don't worry, I got you. So no, but it's funny that you say that the message is not important, because I was the most stage frightened person you could imagine. Mm. And for me, it was the idea of having a message made me like, okay, who cares, like, how's my hair? Who cares if people like me? The message is bigger. But I also think that because comedy has this incredible ability to connect people, that maybe you're right, that having that moment of connection with laughter is so important and empowering. And I'm just curious, you know, in terms of going beyond the message, what actions do you think that we can take beyond what messages we do carry, whether conscious or unconscious?
Well, I think whenever we're having conversations, I'll go back to the Hillary Clinton quote, where they say women's rights are human rights. Disability rights are women's rights are human rights. And I think people forget that. And that a lot of times when people are rattling off the minority groups that are being targeted, or rattling off the people who policies are affecting, or rattling off where diversity is missing from something like the Oscars or from television, they always forget disability. They never list us as one of the groups. Mm. And
we're going to change that.
Yeah.
We got this.
I'm working on it.
We got this. And you guys are going to help.
I'm doing some big stuff, kids. Stay tuned. No, but we have a couple of different things that we say. One is nothing about us without us.
Right.
So when Sean and I were sitting in the audience, I was like, don't forget my Hollywood manifesto. So disabled people are 20% of the population. We're the largest minority in the world. We cut every single diversity group you can think of. So we're part of the LGBTQ community. We're of all different faiths, all different economic statuses. And even though we're 20% of the population, we're only 2% of the images you see on TV. Of those 2%, 95% are played by non-disabled actors.
Yeah.
So when you do see us on TV, it's not us. It's not us telling our stories.
Right.
So I think one of the things that we have to do is create more positive images of disability in media.
Right. And I just want to give a shout out to Real Abilities, because actually they're part of the reason that we're here. But we love Real Abilities. But why I joined was I realized that, you know, just having my disability didn't mean I was the expert on all
right.
disability. And what I wanted, not only to see great film and see what was being, you know, what's out there about people with disabilities, but I wanted to learn. I wanted to learn about PTSD, about Alzheimer's, about autism, and all these other disabilities.
And that's what happened to me after the TED Talk. Like, after the TED Talk, I was educated on all these different disabilities I didn't know about. I got an education about invisible disabilities, which, you know, don't get the visibility that we do. I think I should plug my show now.
Okay.
So
here we go.
And we're going to start off with a really,
I wish I had a show to plug to, but maybe next
Inshallah,
time.
In the future.
Thank
next
you.
Time.
Thank you.
Yeah. So two really depressing statistics, because I like statistics. There's a day of mourning for people with disabilities that are killed by their parents and caretakers. Oh. People with disabilities are the one group that, when we are murdered, people find sympathy in the murderer. So when the stories post, you see something like, the mother was at the end of her rope. The father couldn't afford the care anymore, so he decided to take him to heaven with him. You don't hear these excuses being made for other people who are murdered. And the statistic, which I think is the most shocking thing I've ever heard, and you can follow this up, 50% of all people killed by law enforcement are people with disabilities. 50%. So the reason I think it's so important to have positive images on disability on TV is I think we can shift the stigma. I think that parents fear having a child with a disability instead of seeing the potential of it. I think that the people hiring us in Hollywood think we're going to cost too much, we're going to need too many accommodations, and they don't realize that we're worth the investment, right? Because people with disabilities have the buying power of the entire country of China. Let's be honest, that's all people care about, how much can we sell.
1.3 billion of us.
So I'm doing a sitcom. Sean Hayes and Hazy Mills has a production company called Hazy Mills Production, a subsidiary of NBC Universal, if anyone needs to have a disclaimer there. And we're doing a sitcom called If I Can Can. And what we want to do is mainstream disability. Because anytime we do see disability, it's always the same three subjects. You can't love me because I'm disabled, heal me, or kill me. That's all we get to do. So what we wanted to do was create a mainstream character who struggles with work and her family and love and money and all the other things. And according to the history books, it's going to be the first time a woman with a visible disability is the lead of a show.
So. Woo! Perfect time to plug this here, right?
My head writer is also a woman, so we're trying to stack the deck with women, because it's very strange to find a women-led writer's room or women directors or women creators, so we're going to be very, very women-heavy.
Boss ladies, I love it.
It's going to be fun.
So actually what you were saying about pity, and it made me think about something else that, you know, when I was preparing for this, I realized that for me, when I use comedy, a lot of times it's also to take my own narrative back, because I'll get, oh, I'm so sorry, you know, and I want people to know. In my case, I feel like my disability is this incredible blessing that I get to do this every day and talk about these issues. And so for me, it's about flipping that narrative. So I will say, oh, but you don't know, I have VI ski, and like all these things that I just normally do, but I realize that subconsciously it is about changing that narrative. So what do you think comedy can do in terms of, I feel like it's a bridge, but I mean.
Interesting. You know, in real life, I wear a lot of makeup. So like I have two distinctly different looks. Either I look like the Lost Kardashian, or I look like I do right now. And the reason I go in public without makeup sometimes is because I want people to know it's okay. I do. Yeah. But you have to like go to Maysoon.com, shameless plug, Maysoon.com, and you will see I wear like lashes for days and like contour and the whole thing. And what I'm honestly trying to do is bring sexy back to disability. Mm. I really don't use my comedy to disarm the disability as much as I use the comedy to protect the Muslim side of me. Because even though we are under siege as a community, as a Muslim in America right now, it's daily death threats, it's daily bigotry, it's daily incitement of violence by, you know, the sexual predator in power. And so I use my comedy much more to kind of explain that, you know, I am American and I'm not imposing Sharia law, or am I? And, you know, for the comedy, I'm trying to bring sexy back to comedy.
Yeah.
So I do the Lost Kardashian thing minus the videos and the belfies, because I don't have the coordination for the belfie. Like I've been trying and it's just blurfy. And I'm trying to bring sexy back to disability. Yeah. People think that women with disabilities are these happy snowflake angel babies that never grow up and never feel anything and are definitely not sexual. And I think that's what I'm trying to do most with comedy when I talk about mainstreaming is to say, we are adults, we do fall in love, we are worth being partners with. When I see those viral videos of like, captain of the football team asks out girl in a wheelchair, I'm like, maybe he's lucky she's going out with him. Maybe that's not actually the charity. So I think I'm trying to bring sexy back to disability.
Yeah, well, I think it never left. It was always there.
Girl, it left.
Oh, okay.
I'm gonna talk about it.
You brought it back.
30 years. It's been 30 years since Marlene Matlin won the Oscar for Children of a Lesser God. I can go through this whole audience ask you guys to tell me, name a mainstream movie where an actually disabled actress played a romantic lead. Mm. Marlene Matlin 30 years ago, people. So like, that's why, even though we knew we were sexy, I know, like, I'm the vibrating bed. Like, what more do you want? But we're not there on TV. We're not the love interest. We're not on the soap operas. General Hospital still doesn't have a visibly disabled person. Everyone in a wheelchair is still healed, you know? And our friends with autism face much more discrimination than we even do.
Right. Well, that's also, I want to take a second to plug Real Abilities again, because last year was the first year that every single film, except for one, featured real people with disabilities in the films. We choose from about 1,000.
Do you remember my panel?
I wasn't there. I heard it was explosive. There were fireworks.
Last year, I was on a panel with William H. Macy, who I love more than lunch meat. I think he's so brilliant, and I love him. And he accidentally spoke before me. And he played a disabled character on like a Lifetime movie called like Knock the Door or something. He played a guy who has cerebral palsy. And he was talking all about like how much he loved it and how much he learned. And then it was my turn and I was like, okay, I love you so much. You're like my most favorite actor in the world, but you are so offensive. I can't believe you crept up. And I gave him a whole lecture about how like the majority, disability is not a monolith, but we have like a big gaggle who is 100% against non-disabled actors playing disabled on television. We think it's really offensive because physical disability is not like a bunch of twitches and eye movements, and people look at them and they think, oh, we should give them an Oscar. And we look at them and we think it's cartoonish and it's inauthentic and it's offensive. So I said to him, you know, would you play Michelle Obama? And he said, yes. And I was like, no, dude, you wouldn't. Like, I understand that you feel like you would, but when you walked into the audition and sat down between a bunch of, you know, black women auditioning to play Michelle Obama, you would get up and leave. And we need people to do that with disability. So when you talk about proactive, boycott TV shows and movies with people who are not disabled playing disabled roles. It's offensive, it's inauthentic, and if we keep allowing it to happen, then people with disabilities will never get those roles. We'll never get to tell our story.
Well, I think that's a great place to, I just want to say, I think one of the beauties about you and why you have been so successful is you're one of the most authentic people that I've ever met. And I just want to thank you for taking this time.
I have to tell them the one authentic story.
So okay, we're not done. There's more.
I've known Sean forever, ever, like at least 5 years. And we share a mentor, Laureen Arbus, coolest woman ever born. Google her, women leadership.
Oh my
gosh. Laureen Arbus.
She's a queen.
She's my fairy god mentor.
And our fairy god mentor.
Our fairy god mentor. So anytime I see Sean, I'm like, CB for life. Yes, Sean, go Sean. So it was last year, this exact time, and we were at the White House. And we had been invited to talk about disability at the White House 6 days after the Orange Menace took office. And we're in security, and Sean's like, hey, Maysoon! And I was like, bah! And she's like trying to talk to me the entire way in, and I wouldn't talk to her. And then we finally got inside, and I was like, this is it. I'm not gonna come back here because you know. And I just like started crying in the middle of the White House. And then I looked at Sean and I was like, I'm sorry, I'm being mean, but Donald Trump won and I have Trump-pression. And that was like the most authentic we've ever been, because I felt so bad that I was so rude to you, but I couldn't muster up any positivity.
You were never rude.
Positivity.
You were just,
yeah, I was.
No.
You said hi and I said,
But she also said she's traveling 280 days out of the year. So
I
the fact that she
180 days last year.
I know.
So, and I never ever want to have a baby.
I think you get more than a pass. You get a pair of wings, as far as I'm concerned.
They give me wings on the airplane, and then they leave me a crawl across the runway when they don't bring the wheelchair at the end. So,
I always want those little wings they give the kids.
You don't. It's really sharp.
I do. No. Yeah. Oh, okay.
I think
dangerous.
Our time is
actually,
done.
Actually, don't do it. Okay.
Is our time done? Because we can just
yeah. Right. Okay. I think we might be just about. Are we right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So, round of applause for Xian Horn.